Hello, this is the third part of the high poly modeling of the butcher cleaver in zbrush. So the stuff that you're looking at now is sped up 4 times, and the reason for that is because I was kind of messing around with the horns in zbrush, and halfway through it I realized that this is kind of a hard surface mesh and I'd be better off just modeling it in Blender, but I wanted to keep this part into the video. So this is the part in zbrush for the horns, and then after about 7 minutes I'll be switching to Blender, and then I'll explain how I go through that part. Okay, so at this point, I'm gonna decimate the mesh and then export it as an OBJ and import it into Blender, because this is getting a little bit too tedious, and I'll be able to use this as a guide to what I'm gonna be doing in Blender. So the trick is here, I'm gonna create a curve, a Bezier curve, and I'm gonna position it roughly in the same position as the horns, and I'm gonna only do this on one side. And then what we're gonna do is we're gonna use a array curve modifier, and I'm using the modal tools from Pitywazoo for this, but you can do it just with regular modifiers as well. So now that I have the curve, I'll create a basic cylinder. Doesn't really matter what the topology is of the cylinder or the division, even the rotation you can mess around with later. And so I'm going to select the curve and then the mesh, and then I'm going to do array by curve, and then it basically just maps it there. So now I'm going to create an empty, and the trick here is to use the object offset and not the relative offset, and then select the empty. And now you'll be able to, by moving the empty on one axis, you'll be able to control it, the position. And the reason for doing this is that if I scale the empty, as you'll see in a second, it will create a kind of a gradual scale on the array curve, as you can see here. And this is a really useful effect that you only really can get with the object offset. So now I can just go into the edit mode of the object and start messing around with it, and then the moment I go back into object mode, it'll snap back to the curve. And this is all non-destructive, so I can just at any point reposition the curve and adjust the geometry and move around the empty. So I'll basically be doing this for a while, messing around with getting the position right and the shape correct and all that stuff, and then I'll export it and get it back into ZBrush. So now I'm gonna export it from Blender and get it back into ZBrush. And then in ZBrush, I'll be duplicating the mesh, mirroring it over, and then merging it down so I have a symmetrized object. And I'll probably go back to Blender at some point to add the first piece, because as you can see, the root of the horn is very large compared to what the guide suggested. So I'll take it back to Blender in a bit, and then I'll just add another piece for the root and a piece for the end, as you'll see. So now that I have all pieces, I can position them a little bit and sculpt the end out, the end piece. I'm just using the flattened brush and the clay brush and stuff like that, nothing special. So in general, the horns have a little bit of a more organic shape to it now, and we have all the pieces there, and it's just cleaner overall. So the next step will be to get rid of the half of the skull's right horns, because in the concept he only has one side of his horns intact, and then we'll start detailing out the horns a bit. At this point, I can add some damage to the horns in a bit of a stylized way. So I'm just trying to space it out a little bit. I'm using the carve brush that I have. Don't remember the actual name, but it's basically like a hard cutting brush. So it's very sharp. It's good for cracks and scratches and stuff like that. So I'll go over the entire horn now, adding some damage like this, and then I'll move to the other side. So what I want to do now is I want to deviate a bit from the concept and add some kind of grip onto the wooden stick, kind of a handle. So I'll take it, I'll decimate this piece, and then take it back into Blender, and I'll do the same kind of similar thing to what I did with the horns, and create a grip for it. So I'm decimating it here. Decimating it takes a while. So now back in Blender, I'm gonna create another Bezier curve, and I'm gonna. And the Bezier curve was a little bit offset because of the 3D cursor position. So I'm gonna kind of roughly rotate this curve and extrude it along where the grip would be. And I could do this in ZBrush as well, just sculpting on top of the stick. But I think this will give me kind of a cleaner look, and I think at the end of the day, this is gonna be faster as well. So this is a little bit tedious. Maybe there's a better way of doing this. I guess you could snap to the geometry. So I'm just roughly rotating it around the mesh, and then I'll create a cube and make it more into a rectangular piece, and again do array by curve around this curve, and it'll kind of wrap itself around the stick. Create kind of like a grip look. So things are gonna get a little bit messy here, as you can see. I think it was because of the pivot of the curve. So you see the whole position is way off, and I think I realized after a few minutes that it's because of the pivot position. So I'm resetting the pivot now, and now it still looks a bit messy, but it looks like it's in the right position. So now I'm just gonna mess around with the offset, and then ultimately I'll have to rotate the object because it's at rotated on the wrong axis. So I can just go into edit mode. So first I'm trying to just change the axis, but that doesn't work, so I have to make sure to use the same axis as the curve. So now I'm rotating it, and now it should kind of line up in a better way. It still looks messy, but it's because of the subdivision level on the object. So once I add some loops, you'll see that it'll start wrapping around the object. Yep. So now what you see is that the it's kind of tilted in an awkward way around the curve. So there is a tilt option in the curve. I think I'm messing around with hotkeys. I couldn't find the right hotkey here, but if you select the vertices on the curve, there is a tilt option in the under the transform parameters, and that will allow you to rotate it on its axis. There you go. So you can do this for the individual vertices, or you can do it for the whole object. So eventually I figured out my hotkey for this. In my case it was Control Z, but I think it's different for you. And so then you can easily adjust each individual piece. So I'll be messing around now a little bit with that, and then ultimately adjusting the geometry, adding some subdivision and creating it a little bit, giving it a little bit more of a an organic shape. So there's a small part of the recording that's missing, and it's basically me adding some detail to the skull. As you can see here, the skull has detail on it, some scratches and stuff like that. And also at the very end of the stick, there's some chains that were attached. So I'm gonna redo the detailing on the skull so you can see that. And but I'm not gonna redo the chains. And so the chains were done in the exact same way as the grip, using a curve in Blender. So there's nothing special about that. So now I'm gonna mess around with the skull. As you can see, I had it as a layer. I'm just gonna recreate that. So removing the layer on the duplicate. There we go, and I'm just gonna redo it. So I made a few mistakes here. I think I accidentally worked without the symmetry on. So I was working on one side of the skull for a while until I realized that I didn't have symmetry on. So then at some point I tried to use the smart resim, but the smart resim doesn't really work very well with decimated meshes. So what I did then, and I think I cut that part out of the video, is that I just remove one side of the face. So by selecting it and deleting it, then duplicating the part, mirroring it over, and then merging it, and then doing another decimation on it, and then it kind of, there's like a little bit of a seam in the middle, but you can easily clean it up. So at this point, I'm nearing the end, and just do another quick decimation on the skull, and now I'm gonna just start adding the same kind of detailed damage that you have on the other version on the left. So I'm just gonna use the left version as kind of a guide to what I did before. So it's again using the same brush to create cuts and scratches. And there's no, I guess there's some right way of doing it. I'm just doing it by eye and using the flattened brush also to create kind of cuts or big cuts into the object. It's just kind of a bit of a stylized, simplified damage, really. And I think you, if you spend a good amount of time doing it right, getting the placement good, you know, you can get really good results doing it. I'm kind of rushing through this a little bit at this point, because I had to redo it once, and you know, it's a bit bothersome. Okay, so I think I'll continue doing this for a while and then do some more detail on some of the other pieces. All right, so I think this is pretty much it. That's the whole high poly process done for the butcher's cleaver. There's definitely some more detail here and there that I could be adding. On the chains, I think ultimately I'll kind of model those out in a straight way so that I could rig them on the low poly and just have an easier time baking it. But that's it for the high poly. I hope this was useful to some of you. Have a good day.